Hey everybody, it's Oof again, and I'm going to just go ahead and do another quick mini review. This time we're going to go ahead and dive into the new Marvel series, Scarlet Spider, starting with issues number 1 and 2. '90s comics these days tend to get a bit of a beatdown, and to be fair, they deserve a bit of it. While it's unfair to say that everything was bad about 90s comics, there was a lot that was. There was an increase in the ever-popular Grimdark. We got to see the prominent rise of such artists as Rob Liefeld. Oh, and hey, the Clone Saga. Yeah, there's a bit of a dark spot on Marvel's history. You won't see them bringing that up in the movies anytime soon. So for comic book fans, or at least newbies to comic books, the Clone Saga is one of the dark periods in Marvel's history. Basically, it was at a 90s resurrection and a 70s plot point in the Spider-Man series that pretty much went nowhere. It was confusing, it was plotted along, it didn't really make a lot of sense, and it really just felt like nobody knew what they were doing and they were making it up as they went. And it showed. But much like 90s comics, there were some good things that came out of the Clone Saga. Maybe I'm in the minority here, but I like Scarlet Spider. Yeah, he's just Peter, but if you read the Spider-Man The Lost Years, which nobody did, because nobody cared by that point, his character development was actually very interesting. And same thing with Kane, who is the flawed clone. Again, a lot of people feel he's too 90s these days, what with the long hair and the grizzly beard and the scar of Cain and the mark of Cain. But yeah, I liked the character. I thought they were interesting additions to the Spider-Man universe. We could have done without Spider-Side, but, you know, take the good with the bad. So, it's interesting then that I bring those two up, because guess what? They're the star of the new series! Okay, well, sort of, both of them. Let me explain. So, the story picks up basically after the Spider Island story arc from Amazing Spider-Man. Oh, right, by the way, spoilers. So, at the end of Spider Island, Kane, who was turned into Tarantula by the Jackal and the Insect Queen after he was resurrected, because comic books can't keep things simple for some reason, he was then cured by being dumped into the cure that was being made to cure everyone else from Spider Island, which somehow cured him of all his other genetic deficiencies, but left him with all of Spider-Man's powers, which, whatever. Science! Anyway, so deciding he wants to become his own man, Kane headed out to Mexico, or at least that was the plan. Along the way, he ends up in Houston, and, well, superhero hijinks ensue. And, to be honest, I'm really loving this series so far. I mean, Avenging Spider-Man turned out to be a bit of a letdown, at least in my opinion, and I could get into that another time, but this is starting off really strong. Yost has really done a good job of developing Kane's character. He's not just another goody-two-shoe superhero that we're all familiar with and love, but he's not just another anti-hero who goes around being grimdark all the time either. Yeah, he's depressed and upset with himself because he has a lot to repent and atone for, but he ends up going through it anyway, but he's still doing the best he can, even though he kind of sucks at it right now. And he's still doing the right thing, even though it takes him a little while to come to that decision. He's a very complex character, and we still don't see that a lot of times. And I'm not saying that every character has to be that way, but it makes for a much more fascinating hero to get behind. And not only that, there's a lot of other things that are great about it. Salamander, the villain introduced in the first two issues, is really neat. We don't know anything about him. Why is he pursuing Arcelli, one of the other characters introduced? Where did he get his fire powers from? Is he really a descendant or recipient of some gift from the gods? Or is he just a crazy mutant or something? I don't know, the book doesn't explain it. The other additional characters, like Arcelli, as well as the doctor and the police officer we're introduced to, are really neat supporting characters. And the fact that it's in Houston, where there aren't a lot of Marvel characters other than maybe Ghost Rider these days, it kind of separates itself from the rest of the Marvel Universe, which I like. And in addition to Yost's writing, Stegman's art hits it out of the park. It's just wonderful stuff. Truthfully, I don't have any complaints about these issues. They're excellent. Except for some petty fan nitpicking. Like the costume, primarily. Okay, there's nothing wrong with the costume. It looks fine, and it's cool, and all that good stuff. But its design is extremely different from the stealth costume that Kane was given during the Spider Island arc. Why? Maybe this was in one of the .1 issues or something like that I just didn't pick up, but I'm kind of confused by the design change. Also, come on, we're going to call him Scarlet Spider and not include the hoodie? Maybe even just as a throwback? Please? But as I said, as far as actual complaints about the content or the price or anything like that, you're going to hear nothing from me. I absolutely love this comic, and if you love Spider-Man comics, please pick this up. This is a series we absolutely should support because it is excellent. And I'm going to go ahead and give it a high mark, the highest mark I give, and give it an A. It is absolutely worth picking up. Alright, well, thanks again for checking out my little mini-review, and I'll have the full review up as soon as I can get Windows Live Media Maker to stop being stupid. Peace out, everybody.
Let's wreck this dog.
It's really fascinating. Kane isn't just the typical goody-two-shoe superhero, but he's not a grim, dark... Yost has really...